there and welcome to another episode of Eye on Port. It's proudly brought to you by West Blue Consulting Limited, Ghana Oil Company Limited, and also Ghana Community Network Services. The proud media partner for the program is the Business and Financial Times. People, this week there is a lot of disagreement between shipping lines as well as freight forwarders and some business associations within the port and maritime industry. It is because of something called terminal handling charges. We are going to be talking to all the partners involved in this particular disagreement, and that would include the Institute of Freight Forwarders, also the Association of Businesses, key businesses like the Chamber of Commerce, the AGI, and the rest. We will also be hearing from the shipping lines themselves, and as well, we will be talking to an important mediator when it comes to this particular matter, that's the Ghana Shippers Authority. In the meantime, let's try to unpack what this whole disagreement is about.
Terminal Handling Charges, THC, is the charges collected by terminal authorities at each port against handling equipment and maintenance. THC varies from port to port of each country, as the cost of handling at each port differs one to another port, depending on the total cost of port terminal handling at each location.
It's a global nomenclature that refers to the part of the shipping lines discharge and loading process.
Normally, terminal handling charges, THC, for exports is collected from shipper by shipping lines while releasing bill of lading after completion of export customs clearance procedures. Regularly, the THC is paid at the ports of loading only. As per terms of delivery, if a buyer has to pay such port of handling THC, such THC is paid at the loading port by either buyer's representative or his authorized agent.
They come as a composite freight charge,
okay,
where you have the basic freight, some surcharges, sometimes bunker charge is part of the composite. Then the terminal handling charge is also a part of it from source.
The import terminal handling charges is collected by shipping carriers at the time of issuing delivery order to consignee to take delivery of goods. In Ghana and West Africa at large, the THC was fused into the all-in freight and was charged as one component until recently.
In the developed countries like US, China, Shanghai, when you get your freight, the freight sits separately from the THC.
The terminal handling charge.
Yes. In West Africa, this has not been the case. The practice is that we give you an all-in freight.
However, beginning the 25th of July, shipping lines are asking shippers to begin to pay the THC as a separate component from the all-in freight and make such payment in Ghana as a destination fee instead of paying at the port of loading.
The THC in Tema had been advertised. So at the time they were shipping, they knew that apart from paying the THC at the port of loading, you come and pay a separate THC in Tema.
With the new charges, shippers are expected to pay $140 to $155 for a 20-footer container and $260 to $275 for a 40-footer container. This development has not gone down well with Ghanaian businesses, saying it will burden the shipper, who will then pass it on to the final Ghanaian consumer and bring hardship onto citizens.
The consumer is the one who would suffer, and we are all consumers.
Yes.
We are all consumers. If we bring our goods in and we are not able to sell, what are we up to?
Recently, the president of Ghana charged stakeholders at the ports to see how to reduce charges at the ports.
One of the things that I will urge is that the Port Authority, Customs, Ministry of Transport, and all the stakeholders in the port business take a look at the multiple charges that we continue to charge.
We are worried that if shippers have to be burdened with that as a local charge, it certainly would increase the cost of doing business for them and probably even make our ports uncompetitive.
In this sense, shippers and businesses rejected the enforcement of the THC payment in Ghana as a separate component. The stakeholders further petitioned the Minister of Transport, who called for the suspension of the implementation of the THC. Meanwhile, in a letter titled Suspension of Terminal Handling Charges in Ghana, the transport minister wrote that the Ghana Maritime Authority would investigate the issues raised by the shipping companies and make recommendations to the ministry on the justification for the introduction of such charges in Ghana in 2 weeks, and that the terminal handling charges be suspended effective 10th of August 2016, pending the outcome of the investigation and advice from the Ghana Maritime Authority. Signed, Honorable Fifi Kwete, Minister, Transport.
Well, so now you know a terminal, you know the terminal handling, and you also know the terminal handling charges and all the issues that have come up. So we decided to listen to all the views and also let you listen to it. And I'm sure that you make your own choices and decisions. And I'm sure that it would also help all the parties involved hear themselves. So we decided to talk first of all to the Ghana Institute of Freight Forwarders. Take a listen to what their position is.
We received some letters about a month ago from some of the shipping lines asking for our usual cooperation for the terminal handling charges to be decoupled and charged at destination.
The same value or probably the same rate, but decoupled from the composite.
No, charges. It doesn't affect what you have paid upstream.
This is separate.
That's it.
Addition to whatever you might have paid upstream.
That's it. And so what happens is that no matter where you paid the freight, if it is freight collect, that is, if you are coming to pay the freight here in Ghana, it means you finish paying that with all of these aggregation, and then they charge you the terminal handling charges. The simple reason is that freight has reduced.
That general international freight has reduced.
Yes.
The rate of it has reduced.
Yeah. And
for which reason they are increasing, they are adding this particular cost.
That's it. That's it. You know, if I should understand freight, it either means that which has been carried or that which has been paid for that which has been carried.
Mm.
So whichever one that has reduced for them, they need to mark up.
So what happens when freight rates again go up?
That's what we
asked. Scrap that?
We didn't get an answer to that. The minister issued a directive for the charges to be stayed. And this is where the killer even begins, you know.
Why? Because they didn't listen to that directive from the minister?
16th
of August.
Of August. They are still charging. Some of them are charging. PIL is charging. Hull Blythe is charging. And a host of them.
So what service are the shipping lines rendering additionally that is requiring this cost to be paid?
If they are rendering any service, probably in the dark, we don't know. Because for us, for what happens for our boxes to be placed in the container yard of what has been stated in the agreement, it's been paid for.
So what next for you now?
Oh, seriously, seeing that they have treated the directive of the minister with utter disrespect, and seeing that a couple of days has passed now and there is no further pronouncement from any source, we see just one way out of this.
Which is what?
To go to court.
No, but you are the leader of the president of the Freight Forwarders Association. Have you one-on-one engaged the shipping lines?
As we speak, a letter is on the way to them. Is it what stayed?
So you haven't written to them all this while.
What actually stayed our hands in this thing is when we made our sentiments known, that is jointly with other business organizations, and the promptness with which the minister responded. And on that very day, whilst we were living there, the letter was prepared.
Okay.
We had our copies even whilst living. And the letter was that forceful. It was unambiguous. The directives were clear.
Do you have plans to personally engage them?
Immediately, today, a letter has been dispatched to them. What is happening, we see it not just as a trade issue. It bothers on sovereignty.
Yeah.
Because most of these companies are multinationals. And if this is how they are going to treat our leaders, and for whatever reason for which the leaders can also not come back to with any other pronouncement, it's a bit baffling.
Having listened to the position of the freight forwarders, we reached out to the shipping lines themselves and we spoke with the Ship Owners and Agents Association to find out what is different. What is different as far as their position is concerned? Why can't they find a common ground with what the freight forwarders are saying?
If you look at global freight, based on which one can say that if I pay you an all-in freight, I'm paying the TAC, this freight have gone down drastically. I mean, a freight rate of 4,500 from Shanghai to Tema about 3 years ago is now only about 2,400. A freight of about 2,500 from the same port to Tema is now about 750. So you realize that if we were giving you an all-in freight of 450,000 for 40 footer, which included the terminal handling charge plus other marine charges, if the freight is now 2,400 and the port charges are going up, then obviously it stands to reason that the shipping lines are making a lot of losses. So that is why we want to separate the freight from the actual marine charge. And since the freight itself has reduced already beyond the margins where the shipping lines can't make profit.
But it wasn't as a result of the fact that you took the THC out.
Basically, the THC component is the cost of the freight rates going down somehow. Over the years, while the freight has come down, the THC has gone up. The rate itself has reduced because of the port charges that have gone up.
They feel this is a duplication because at the source or the origin of importation, they are paying a THC. And it doesn't say that they are supposed to pay THC at the destination.
Now, apart from West Africa, all ports have the rate and the THC for the port of loading. So at the time you were shipping the cargo, you would have paid the port of loading THC. And then the port of discharge TAC, because it was an all-in rate, would have been in the rate that would be quoted to you. Now what we are saying is that aside the port of loading TAC, which is paid separately because the cargo handled at port of loading comes at its cost separately, if you come to the port of loading, the same cargo handling would happen. And you can't say that because you have paid a TAC at the port of loading, you are going to say that it covers the port of discharge TAC. No.
Did you engage the West African shippers who were not used to this particular practice and now being thrown to them?
This TAC to be paid at the port of discharge in West Africa were advertised at the headquarters of most of the shippers on their websites about 3 months ago. And all of them in Europe, it's not like
that it was going to be implemented
in Tema, or let's say all the West African ports within the stipulated time. Everybody was aware.
So were there talks with them to understand this decoupling?
They knew what was being introduced, they knew the repercussions of it, and they agreed.
They agreed.
Obviously, when you go there and it's explained to you, and you pick a container, ship, and a bill of lading is given to you, it means that you have agreed to the terms of the shipment.
So then it becomes mind-boggling when you get your goods get to Tema and now you start complaining that you
can't. I'm not aware. That is erroneous, and that's what the shipping lines don't understand.
Are you willing to facilitate some negotiation between the shippers and then the shipping lines?
This can easily be resolved if the consignees or the shippers could sit down with the shipping lines, trash this issue out. There can be negotiation. Our doors are always opened.
The minister gave the directive. After that directive, some of the shipping lines are still taking the THC.
Before the minister gave his ruling, the shippers and the consignees have gone to the shipping line, have shipped the cargo under a certain term of shipment and certain term of payment. Remember that all the containers that you see here that people are seeking to clear had been shipped for about 1 or 2 months under that term. And so in shipping, if you say stop collecting that TAC, you are going against a term of contract that had been established a
couple of months ago before the directive.
Definitely. At the time he gave that fiat, did he do it considering the terms of shipment? Did he know that there was going to be repercussions on how the agents?
So maybe he could have said that beginning the 10th of August.
For all cargo being shipped, then you can get a bill of lading with the date 10th of August, then that applies.
Yes.
But when you say 10th of August,
stop collecting.
Yes,
that collecting what? You wanted to affect even cargoes that have been shipped a couple of months ago. So are those the containers or cargoes that the shipping lines are still charging on it? Those that had the contract
before the commissioner's order is what the charges are being affected? Yes.
Well, the shipping lines still believe that they have a point to make there, but you know, if you listen to the interview, they are still opening their doors for negotiations. So I'm sure that not all hope is lost. But we moved again to speak with the business associations that deal with some of these shipping lines, and you know, their day-to-day business is affected by the decision that has been taken by the shipping lines. They are also not happy at all.
In the earlier or the previous practice, whatever was being charged, was there a component that took care of this terminal handling charges per whatever engagement
it's
you had?
It's supposed to be. It's supposed to be. There is a component that takes care of this terminal
you handling charge. You had that charge. Understanding
way That is the understanding. Okay. That is the understanding. Because what is the terminal handling charge? What is the shipping line asking for the terminal handling charge for? For the fact that when the vessel gets to Tema port, it has to be brought down by a stevedore. Now, other lines charges evacuation. A line like Mole, they charge evacuation.
I see.
For evacuating the containers, I guess, to the terminal. But this charge is something that the terminal operators do charge us. And when I say the terminal operators, I'm referring mostly to the off-dock terminals, like Golden Jubilee, Meridian, TCT, exactly. Now, if a shipping line comes in and tells me to pay terminal handling charge, I'm asking, what is it for? You are not operating a terminal. So what is
You're questioning whether it's not a duplication of what you're already paying to the other operators.
Exactly. That has been clarified. That is different from the terminal operators. This is the shipping line. Then again, we come and say, if it is a charge that is going to the shipping line, I have already paid for it. Because this charge is supposed to take care of bringing the cargo down. You know,
cargo down from the vessel,
from the origin. I have paid the freight, so this is supposed to be bringing the cargo down from the vessel. They are claiming the stevedoring charges were high, GPHA was increasing their tariff every 3 months, and all that. GPHA has come out clearly.
Is that true?
GPHA came out,
GPHA increased price in 2016.
And we are saying that if there's any justification for this charge, add it to the freight. You are saying it's a component of the freight. You want to decouple it. There are times where a component of the freight, like the bunker, goes very high. When they quote the freight, they isolate that. You will see bunker adjustment factor.
Yeah.
So much amount, it is added, and you have your total ocean freight that you pay. Mm-hmm. We understand it. Mm-hmm. So if there's a need to charge for the terminal, put it there. Terminal handling charge. Isolate it as part of the freight and let the shipper decide. But we think that this is an avenue for them to avoid competition amongst themselves.
Among themselves? But I thought they all agreed to do this.
Oh, they are agreeing to this because they've tried other areas or other alternatives that didn't work.
Should they decide not to treat it as a destination charge and make it an origin charge, wherever the goods are originating from, and let you pay from there? Won't it be the same? Because they can choose to say, okay, don't pay it in Tema. We'll let you pay, say, in Amsterdam, where the thing is coming from, or in New Jersey before it arrives. Wouldn't that be the same?
It wouldn't be the same, because then it becomes part of the freight. And once it becomes part of the freight, then the shipper can decide whether I want to go with line A or line B, because then I'll negotiate. Okay. And whichever line gives me the best rate, I'll go with that line. And that is what they want to avoid, the competition. So we think that we are being taken advantage of.
Okay.
Ghanaian shippers have been taken for granted for far too long. It looks as if the shipping industry is an avenue to make some cool money. Anybody, everybody gets up, introduces a charge, starts collecting, and that's it. The shipper has no voice. But it's about time we speak, and this time we are saying no. When the rates were high, we were paying, and the shipping lines didn't come to say that, oh, because rates are too high,
let's
I'm giving
you
50%. No, there was no rebate like that.
But now that it's low, you are trying to get monies from it.
Exactly, and we don't think it's fair. If you look at other areas of trade in Europe, of course, yes, you realize that freight rates have fallen. But here in Ghana, we don't see that much difference. In 2012, from Japan, I was paying freight of $4,000 for a 40-footer container. In 2016, I have a freight invoice of $4,200. Where is the fall? It's even higher.
I see.
Where is the fault? So seriously, THC has no justification whatsoever.
Now the minister says they should hold on and not be charging. We are told that some of the lines are still charging.
That's the case. There are invoices as at 17th August. From I've seen from PIL. Charging terminal handling charge. We are in Ghana, and you can imagine that a minister of the land gives an instruction and a shipping line flouts it. For what reason? Where are they deriving the power from?
The argument I heard on that was that if you are clearing now, your vessel might have set off about 2, 3, or even 1.5 months ago, and that was before the minister.
Listen, you had agreed
that you pay all those charges before the minister.
It is untrue. They gave the notices. Some of them, especially PIL, said they were starting on the 25th of July. On the 25th of July, when they started charging, are they saying that vessels that berthed in Tema on the 25th of July sailed the day before wherever they were coming from? No, they had already sailed with a particular contract months before.
Because all of these things, the back and forth, the ordinary people sitting at home maybe may not even understand, but there's a huge repercussion on consumption out there.
The consumer is the one who would suffer, and we are all consumers.
Yes.
So imagine that shippers say, well, I don't have an option. If I don't go clear my cargo, the shipping line is going to charge me demurrage. If I clear my cargo, I'm supposed to pay THC that I don't want to pay. So I leave the cargo. Is that what we want?
That can be dangerous.
It can be dangerous. We really have to, should I say, flex our muscles? That's what we expect from the government. That is what we expect from. We have a very high expectation from the government, and we expect that, of course, the minister will be firm and insist that the charge should be suspended, and even all those who have already charged should make a refund.
Well, everybody seemed to have a point or two to make, but I'm sure that as you listen to all the concerns, you are putting A to B and then to C, and you are making your own conclusions. I'm sure they themselves are understanding that it's about time they all sit around one table and get this resolved for the interest of the consumers as well as they themselves in business. Because people, whether we like it or not, like the president said the last time when he came here, if this port or the ports of Ghana shut down, the entire country will shut down. The businesses that go on here affect almost everybody, whether you are in urban community or you are in a rural setting, you definitely use a thing or two that is imported. That's why this subject is very critical for you. So we want again to see some institution that we believe can mediate among all these parties that we've spoken to. And that's the Ghana Shippers Authority. To find out from them, what's the way forward?
The Ghana Shippers Authority has described as worrying the introduction of terminal handling charges by shipping lines in the country. The Deputy Chief Executive Officer of GSA says the terminal handling charges, if not withdrawn, would increase the cost of doing business in the country. She alluded that shippers are already saddled with many charges, making the introduction of the terminal handling charges untimely and will make Ghana's ports uncompetitive.
So we are worried that if shippers have to be burdened with that as a local charge, it certainly would increase the cost of doing business for them and probably even make our ports uncompetitive. So these were some of the sentiments that were raised. And our ministry, our sector minister, that's the Ministry of Transport, also was concerned about that, and as a result, they invited all the various stakeholders to a meeting.
She said it is untrue that regulatory agencies have increased charges against the shipping lines, hence warranting the introduction of the THC. She said both Ghana Ports and Harbours Authority and Meridian Port Services have not increased charges in 2016.
They told us that of late there has been increases in stevedoring charges by the Ghana Ports and Harbours Authority as well as the MPS, and that has warranted the introduction of this terminal handling charge as a local charge. We met with the GPHA to find out whether indeed what the shipping lines had indicated to us was a fact, you know. And GPHA indicated to us that they have not seen anything new to warrant such an introduction, because they haven't moved away from their line of operation. Anytime they wanted to introduce a levy or increase any charge relating to Steve Dorin, they met with various stakeholders, in fact, and that includes Shippers Authority as well, to talk about the new introduction and then the justification for the introduction.
Yeah.
And they do this annually. And in fact, we met with NPS as well, and they also expressed a similar sentiment that if it comes to services, they offer the services. So they didn't understand why the shipping line should charge terminal handling charge without offering any service to the shipper.
She expressed disquiet about the defiance by some shipping lines who continue to charge the THC in spite of the directive by the Minister of Transport.
Most of the shipping lines had adhered to the directive by the minister, you know, but a few like PIL, we've got invoices to that effect. MSC,
okay.
Yes, we have seen invoices. And then CMA. In fact, we have copies of invoices that indicated that they were still charging.
Sylvia Asana advised that all parties come to the table to address the issue for the interest of all parties.
We should exercise some restraint, you know, because the shippers are concerned about such levies on their bill, especially when a directive has come out that from the 10th of August, it should not reflect in the bill. They have a genuine concern.
We will continue to follow the story getting into the next week, because after that, the minister's directive definitely should be expiring, and we'll get you what the outcome will be. Ion Pod returns after the break.
Hello.
Good morning. This is Samantha Wendy. I am sending a purchase order from SAT Ventures International.
Lovely.
For pineapples.
For how many containers?
Our policy for new supplies is 2 containers to start with, but you must deliver within 30 days.
Don't worry at all. I'm going to get you the 4 containers within 30 days or less.
Congratulations, Mr. Apia. You have just secured your first order from SA2 Ventures International. Time to process the paperwork. Do you remember you have exactly 30 days to deliver? To get his pineapple slices from his country to his clients overseas, Mr. Apia and his representatives have to complete a number of regulatory compliance procedures to various international trade stakeholders. For instance, he has to obtain financial documents such as letters of credit, payment receipts and invoices, complete regulatory documents such as declarations, make permit applications, obtain food hygiene certificates, complete transportation documentations such as manifest, bill of lading, and manage port requirements. Going round and round in circles and up and down from office to office, doing the same paperwork over and over again. Stop! Does it really have to be this way? In a single window environment, Mr. Apia can complete processes for his sales invoice, manifest, declarations, permits, certificates, letters of credit, payment receipts, licenses, and all other international trade supply chain processes. Assessing all agencies and stakeholders in one place 24/7. Let's see what happens when Mr. Apia trades in a single window environment. Using single window, Mr. Apia has completed all his international trade procedures through one portal. He has registered his company information, applied for the necessary permit, certificates and licenses, and all that remains is for him to get a text alert for clearance and movement of goods. And that's how simple facilitating international trade could be in a single window environment. You can offer competitive services to your trading partners in China, America, England, India, and yes, even here, in a simpler, faster, and cost-effective way. Single window, the only way to Ghana's economic growth, is in our hands.
When cleaning your vehicle by valeting, steaming, waxing, or polishing, make sure the engine is also sound. Servicing your vehicle with gold synthetic oil and any quality Goil oil massages the engine, removes deposit, protects it from wear and tear for longer lasting performance, and makes your vehicle feel pampered. made for diesel and super engines. Remember, after every 15,000 kilometers of enjoying your ride, service your engine with Goil synthetic oil.
We are a champion. That's why I, Azuma Nelson, 3 times world boxing champion and a patriot. Always choose Goil.
Ashine Pankasa. Goil, good energy.
For all ship repairs and maintenance work, count on the Takoradi Shipyard. Takoradi Shipyard, efficiency, reliability, and perfection.
News and activities happening in and around the ports and maritime industry. Next.
President John Dramani Mahama has inspected the Albert Bosum Chesam Fishing Harbour Expansion Project in Sekendi in the Western Region. The Albert Bosum Chesam Fishing Harbour Expansion Program is being executed by the Japanese engineering consultants, Environmental Consults for Ocean and Human, ICO. According to the president, the impending Sekendi Fishing Harbour is expected to improve the lives of the people of the Western Region. Richard Anamu, the Director General of the Ghana Ports and Harbors Authority, GPHA, who briefed the President on the expansion work, said the estimated cost of the project was 2 million Japanese yen and it is being funded by the Japanese government. Richard Anamu revealed that the project involved the expansion of the breakwaters, creation of new berthing space, walkways, lay-by wharf of 180 meters, a water facility, etc. The project is to be completed by December 2017.
Ghana Oil, also known as Goil, a leading indigenous oil marketing company in the country and currently making great strides in the aviation and bunkering industry, has commissioned its newly refurbished Santase Fuel Station in the Ashanti region. The Goil Santase Fuel Station was in 2014 closed down to make way for the rebranding of Ghana Oil Company, which is part of the transformational strategy of the company. At an impressive ceremony in Kumasi, the Ashanti Regional Minister, John Alexander Akon, commended Goil for its rebranding strategy and the quality of service they provide. He said it is only when Ghanaians patronize Goil products that the local economy will grow, since Goil is a wholly Ghanaian company.
Any other company that is wholly Ghanaian owned and operated successfully, the result is that on the first war, economic room, very normal. But what it means is that if a son is not a council, a whole yet in our country, I say. But it's still here, it implies that we are recapitalizing the banking industry. Banking industry is not more money, the private sector will grow. Private sector will grow, local economy will grow. Local economy will grow, the whole country's economy will also grow. So the line is that the chain ends with going. Invest in Goil for local and national economy of Ghana. That's the way to go.
The managing director of Goil, Patrick Akoli, argued that the petroleum downstream should be in the hands of Ghanaians. He said, but for Goil, the deregulation exercise in 2015 would have brought untold hardships to Ghanaians. He said Goil has embarked on a move to rebrand all their retail outlets in order to make them attractive and customer-friendly. Patrick Akoli said Goil is targeting 30% shares of the oil marketing industry in 2017.
But for Goil, the deregulation where OMCs or oil marketing companies set their own prices would have created a bit of hardship in the system.
The brand ambassador of Goil, Berima Azuma Nelson, encouraged Ghanaians to patronize Goil products so as to sustain the Ghanaian economy.
Hello.
Good morning. This is Samantha Wendy's. I am sending a purchase order from SAT Ventures International.
Lovely.
For pineapples.
For how many containers?
Our policy for new supplies is 2 containers to start with, but you must deliver within 30 days.
Don't worry at all. I'm going to get you the 4 containers within 30 days or less.
Congratulations, Mr. Apia. You have just secured your first order from SA2 Ventures International. Time to process the paperwork. Do you remember you have exactly 30 days to deliver? To get his pineapple slices from his country to his clients overseas, Mr. Apia and his representatives have to complete a number of regulatory compliance procedures to various international trade stakeholders. For instance, he has to obtain financial documents such as letters of credit, payment receipts and invoices, complete regulatory documents such as declarations, make permit applications, obtain food hygiene certificates, complete transportation documentations such as manifest, bill of lading, and manage port requirements. Going round and round in circles and up and down from office to office, doing the same paperwork over and over again. Stop! Does it really have to be this way? In a single window environment, Mr. Apia can complete processes for his sales invoice, manifest, declarations, permits, certificates, letters of credit, payment receipts, licenses, and all other international trade supply chain processes. Assessing all agencies and stakeholders in one place 24/7. Let's see what happens when Mr. Apia trades in a single window environment. Using single window, Mr. Apia has completed all his international trade procedures through one portal. He has registered his company information, applied for the necessary permit, certificates and licenses, and all that remains is for him to get a text alert for clearance and movement of goods.
Hello, good morning. You just ordered 2 container pineapple slices. I was wondering, can I supply you the goods as well?
And that's how simple facilitating international trade could be in a single window environment. You can offer competitive services to your trading partners in China, America, England, India, and yes, even here, in a simpler, faster, and cost-effective way. Single window, the only way to Ghana's economic growth, is in our hands.
When cleaning your vehicle by valeting, steaming, waxing, or polishing, make sure the engine is also sound. Servicing your vehicle with gold synthetic oil and any quality gold oil massages the engine, removes deposit, protects it from wear and tear for longer lasting performance, and makes your vehicle fuel pumped. Made for diesel and super engines. Remember, after every 15,000 kilometers of enjoying your ride, service your engine with Gold Synthetic Oil.
We are a champion. That's why I, Azuma Nelson, 3 times world boxing champion and a patriot, always choose Goal.
Ashine Pankasa. Goal, good energy.
For all ship repairs and maintenance work, count on the Takoradi Shipyard. Takoradi Shipyard, efficiency, reliability, and perfection.
Schedules of vessels sitting in the port, those at anchorage, plus those expected for this week, on the Bank of Ghana exchange rate. Next. That's it for this week's episode of Eye on Port. I hope that I've been able to bring you all the issues around the port and maritime industry closer to you, and you also closer to the port. We'll see you next week. Thank you for watching the program. And thanks to the entire crew, Robert Nyantichi, Solomon Anderson, Joe Lavor, Godwin Kabute, Nelson Fiajo, and also the executive producers, Paul Asariansa and Abena Sewa Opoku Fosu. Thank you.